Welcome. My name is Katie Purcell. I'm one of the applications engineers here at Achronix, and today we're going to talk about best practices in FPGA design when using an integrated network on chip, for example, in the Speedster7t. This video assumes you've already watched our introduction to the Speedster7t network on chip. If you haven't done that yet, check out our training videos page on our website and watch the introduction first. That will give you an introduction to basic information on our network on chip. In this training video, we're going to dive a little deeper. And at the end of the training module, you'll learn how to create a design that connects and interfaces to the NoC, understand how using the NoC can simplify a design by maximizing code reuse and eliminating the need to design clock crossing logic and arbitration logic. You'll learn how the NoC improves routing congestion and makes timing closure easier, and understand the impacts of NAP placement and NAP type on latency and traffic congestion. So let's get started. As you know, the NoC in the Speedster7t gives you guaranteed high performance. With data transfers at up to 2 GHz, the NoC provides over 20 terabytes bisectional bandwidth in the AC7T1500 device. It can also make your design easier. With 160 NoC access points, or NAPs, you can easily connect to any of our interface subsystems to the fabric using simple AXI or data streaming transactions. By handling all clock crossing and arbitration logic, this ultimately reduces design time, routing congestion, and floor planning challenges. So let's get into the details of how you can take advantage of NoC in your design. The FPGA fabric sends transactions on the NoC by connecting to NoC access points, or NAPs. NAPs are located near the intersection of a NoC row and column. There are two modes of NAPs: AXI NAPs, which use the AXI 4 standard. These connect fabric logic to memory subsystems, PCIe, and other points in the FPGA fabric. AXI slave NAPs on rows connect to master logic that initiates transactions, and AXI master NAPs on columns connect to slave logic that respond to transactions. Data streaming NAPs act more like FIFOs. These connect fabric to the Ethernet MAX as well as other logic in the FPGA fabric. Horizontal NAPs communicate with other logic on the same row, and vertical NAPs can communicate with Ethernet or other fabric logic on the same column. If you want to connect to the NoC, you need to instantiate a NAP in your design. Next, we'll dive into some real code so you can see an example of how to do this. For this example, I'm going to make use of our NoC reference design, which is available for download. I'll have more information on how to download it at the end of this video. Here, I'm going to show you how to instantiate an AXI slave NAP in your design. I used Achronix's macro library cell, the ACX NAP AXI slave, which is included in your ACE installation. As you can see, it's primarily standard AXI signals with some extra error and resets and a clock. The clock right here at the top is connected to the clock that's talking to your master logic. The reset signal here, it should be noted that this is for resetting the interface of the NAP, not the NoC itself. Now, to make things easier, I've created a wrapper file that makes use of a system Verilog interface for the AXI signals. This isn't a requirement, but it does make using the AXI NAP interface much easier. You can see here that I've created the slave version of the NAP interface. Now, let's take a look at the interface definition. As you can see, I've used parameters to make the address and data buses easier to configure if needed. All of the AXI signals are defined, and here you can see this allows you to easily define both the master and slave version of the interface. The same signals are defined, but the inputs versus the outputs are different whether you have a master or a slave configuration for the interface. Now let's look at how this is actually used in the code. Here I've instantiated my interface for the NAP, as well as my NAP slave wrapper. Notice that I only need to connect the interface here. Additionally, for my master logic that instantiates the transaction, I can connect to the same interface. Let's go down and look at that logic. So here you can see I'm connecting to the same interface. In my master logic, I will define this interface as a master version of the NAP interface, whereas in my NAP instance, I will define it as a slave interface. As you can see, it makes it a lot easier to pass around an interface compared to all of the signals in the Axie NAP. So now you know how to instantiate a NAP in your code, along with some ideas to make connecting the interface a little easier. For examples of all the NAP types, I recommend you download the NoC Reference Design for examples. Now, let's move on to the design considerations when using NAPs. The placement of NAPs can impact latency and congestion in its design, so it's important for designers to understand how placement can affect performance. The closer a NAP is to the target endpoint, the lower the latency. For example, master logic A, located at column 6, row 5, has to traverse 5 NAPs along the row before reaching the peripheral ring of the NoC and ultimately to the GDDR6 channel shown. Whereas master logic B, located at column 2, row 3, only traverses 1 NAP before reaching its GDDR6 destination. Latency on the rows and columns can easily be calculated. It takes 2 NoC clock cycles, or about 1 nanosecond, from one NAP to the next on rows, and 4 NoC clock cycles, or about 2 nanoseconds, from one NAP to the next on columns. For congestion, you need to consider the number of NAPs located on a single row or column. For example, several NAPs on a single row generating traffic can contribute to more congestion compared to if you spread the NAPs across different rows. Similarly, if several NAPs are all sending transactions to the same target endpoint, the bottleneck can be at that endpoint. Another important distinction is which type of NAP to use when using the NoC to communicate between points in the fabric. First, let's look at Axie NAPs. As you know, these are point-to-point transactions using the AXI4 standard. There is master logic that initiates the transaction and slave logic that responds. One benefit of Axie NAPs is they can communicate between NAPs located anywhere in the fabric. The transaction travels east or west on the row, around the peripheral ring, and down the column. This should be kept in mind because the transaction path affects all Axie NAPs, even if they're located close to each other. As you can see, Axie mode is not optimized for latency when sending transactions between points in the fabric. However, Axie mode is optimized for latency when communicating between the fabric and an interface, and the same NAP can potentially be used to communicate with GDDR6, PCIe, and another NAP in the fabric, allowing for code reuse. Another way to communicate between NAPs is using data streaming. These act much like a FIFO. For data streaming, NAPs must be located on a single row or a single column. The NAPs can send or receive data, and each NAP is numbered along the row or column, with 1 starting at the west incrementing as you go east on a row, and 1 starting at the south incrementing as you go north on a column. Within a row or column, a data streaming NAP can send or receive data from any of the others. The NAP indicates the destination by sending the NAP number, and similarly, the receiving NAP sees the NAP number that sent the data. Additionally, the different logic areas attached to different NAPs can use different clocks. The NoC handles all the clock domain crossing logic, making it easy to communicate between different blocks. So now that you have some more information about placement and NAP types and how they affect the design, let's look at some examples of how to constrain the NAPs so that they are optimized for latency and traffic congestion. While ACE can automatically place your NAPs, as you've seen, the NAP type and placement can really affect the performance of your design. So let's look at a PDC placement constraint file to see how you specify the location of the NAP in your design. This is the PDC file used in our NoC reference design. First, let's look at the example of 2 data streaming NAPs on the same row. You set the placement by specifying the instance name and then the location. The NoC location uses the column number first, followed by the row number. So as you can see, this particular horizontal NAP is placed on column 1, row 3. The NAP S is the same that's used for an Axie NAP slave or a horizontal NAP, both residing on the rows. Notice that both horizontal naps are located on the same row, row 3. Similarly, on the vertical data streaming naps, these are placed on the same column. And finally, down here, we have the Axie Slave and Master naps. These happen to be placed in opposite corners, with the Slave nap in row 1, column 1, and the Master nap on column 9, row 8. Since these are Axie naps, they're able to communicate with a nap located at any location in the device. Now you know about instantiating naps and how to best consider placement and types of naps. Let's dive into a real implementation and see some tips and best practices so you can get the most out of using NoC in your design. For our example, I'm going to use the NoC reference design. The NoC reference design includes data streaming naps. There are two horizontal naps, one transmitting and one receiving. There are two vertical naps, again, one transmitting and one receiving. And finally, a pair of Axie naps in opposite corners, with master logic in the southwest communicating with slave logic in the northeast. Now let's look at some synthesis options to see how these help with our NoC design. This is the FTC constraint file used for Simplify Pro. In this design, there are two different pairs of data streaming logic attached to naps at different locations. In a traditional FPGA design, synthesis tools will see two of the same module and may try to share the logic to reduce area and improve performance overall. However, if the design is attaching the logic to naps that are far from each other, you don't want any logic to be shared between them. By setting our data stream packet module using the SynHigher hard attribute, it tells Simplify to keep the logic separate between multiple instances of the same module. This makes sure all logic associated with a particular nap remains close to that nap and thus improves timing. Now, let's move over to ACE and go through the necessary steps to configure the NoC. In the reference design, these configurations are included, but I'll go through how they were generated. In a project, you want to open up the IP configuration perspective. First, you'll connect a clock input and configure a PLL to generate a 200 MHz clock. As you can see here, I've created a clock input in my I/O pads, and then in the PLL, we've got a 200 MHz NoC clock. Notice that I'm not exposing this to the core fabric, so it won't take up an extra resource in the core, since it only needs to go to the NoC. Finally, you're going to create a NoC configuration. Here you'll choose the target device and use the pull-down menu to choose the options of which clock. We're going to use the NoC clock, which is 200 MHz. Then you go to the next configuration page. This page allows you to disable access to various endpoints. For this design, there's no need to disable access to any of the interfaces, so all you need to do is click Save and then generate the files. This will generate the pin placement and timing constraint files. After running ACE, you can see the final layout of the design. Notice that each group of logic is placed close to the associated nap. And there are very few signals shared between the logic, only clocks and reset. There's very little routing congestion. With a traditional FPGA design, there would be very large data buses routing all over the device. And in this case, because we're making use of the NoC, only clocks and reset really need to be routed across the device. Now let's look at the timing. As you can see, with this design that communicates across the device, it easily meets over 500 MHz. Normally, routing a large data bus across the device, that would be impossible. But because we're using the NoC, all we need to do is route very short distances to the nap, and then the NoC takes care of the rest. Thank you for joining me on this training module. Now you should know how to create a design that connects to the NoC, understand how the NoC can simplify your design by taking advantage of code reuse and the built-in clock domain crossing and arbitration logic. You've seen how the NoC reduces routing congestion and can make timing closure easier. And you should now understand the impacts of nap placement and nap type on the performance of a design. If you haven't done so already, I encourage you to download the NoC reference design. This does require a support account through Achronix. If you don't have one yet, contact support@achronix.com to set yours up. And for more details on the NoC, check out the NoC user guide on our website. And you can always reach us at support@achronix.com to answer more questions. And thank you again for choosing Achronix.